gorgeous slab of bacon. Hello, welcome back to Sage and Stone Homestead. My name is Heather. This is week 3 of the Every Bit Counts Challenge put on by Three Rivers Homestead. And last week we made a hard cheese. Today the hard cheese is essentially done. It does need to age some in my cheese fridge. And in order to put it in the cheese fridge, I do need to bag it up. Now, some people will wax their cheeses. What I like to do is actually cut it up into sizes that I would, you know, normally buy at the grocery store and then vacuum seal them. And this is so when I take the cheese out of the cheese fridge, I don't have to put like this entire wheel of cheese in my big refrigerator and cut off of that. I can leave half of it in the cheese fridge to age a little bit longer and get a little bit more flavor, and the other half we can eat off of. So this is a white Colby made with our goat's milk, and it is supposed to have these little holes in it. It looks beautiful and perfect. And some of you might remember from a couple videos ago in this challenge that my vacuum sealer broke, but fear not. I have not ordered a new one, but I do have these bags that go with my little handheld vacuum sealer, and these will work for today. Let's pack the cheese in. Seal it up like so. And this is where the air gets sucked out by our little device here. There we go. All vacuum sealed. Now these cheeses need to sit in my cheese fridge, which is really just an old wine fridge, for about 4 to 6 weeks before they are fully aged and of the proper flavor. We could eat these now, but they're likely to be kind of crumbly, not as creamy, and they're definitely not gonna have that aged cheese flavor, which with Colby, it's pretty mild. I really enjoy letting our Colby sit for a little bit longer than 4 to 6 weeks if I can, because the flavor just gets that much better. Also, a little bit earlier this morning, I did put away probably about 2.5 or 3 pounds of some of our orange tomatoes from the greenhouse. I just stuck them in the freezer. I will deal with these on a later date. And I'm not sure if this technically counts as preservation or just changing our milk into something else, but I did feed my kefir this morning, and I haven't talked about this whole challenge, but we like to make kefir out of our goat's milk instead of yogurt. It is incredible probiotic food. If you have any ideas what to do with excess kefir grains, I would love to hear it. Hello and welcome back. Today is the 19th, and I'm actually in the middle of cooking dinner. I've got roasted goat shoulder in the oven, and I would like to have some roasted pumpkin along with. So I know that that isn't necessarily food preservation. However, we are not going to be eating this entire pumpkin as a side, and so I will be roasting all of it. Some of it we'll be having with dinner, and some of it we will be packing up and preserving. And like this, I have grown different varieties of squash in the past, but this is easily the largest pumpkin that I've grown. This is a Dutch fork pie pumpkin, and this isn't even one of the bigger ones that are out there in the pumpkin patch. I didn't allow this pumpkin to cure the rind, so it's still kind of soft on the outside. Oh, look at this. You know, there's not as many seeds on the inside as I expected, but look at that big old wall of flesh. Gorgeous. I cannot believe that we grew this. We did. Like, this always amazes me. We've been homesteading for 5 years at this point. This is actually my 6th garden season, and stuff like this, it always amazes me. All right, so the pumpkin is all ready to be roasted, and I wanted to show you the innards of the very large pumpkin. It really wasn't very many. Like, this kind of surprises me. I guess I'm more used to that like jack-o'-lantern type that has a lot of guts on the inside, but clearly this Dutch fork pie pumpkin focuses more on the meat, and that's a good thing. I am gonna do a little bit of rearranging inside my oven. This is the goat that we're having for dinner. I'll show you that. Here, gorgeous. Ooh, we're steaming up. Got some gorgeous goat meat here. It is peeling off the bone rather nicely, but this could stand to be roasted a little bit longer.
So inside the oven, I'm gonna have the pumpkin on the top, but I'm gonna put the goat down below. And let everything roast. Right now the oven is only at 300 degrees because that's what I need for the goat. The goat needs to roast low and slow, and the pumpkin can roast at 300. It's just gonna take a little bit longer than it would if we roasted it at like 350 or something, but that's fine.
Now, as far as these seeds go, I am gonna put these seeds to the side. I think I am not going to save seeds from my Dutch fork pie pumpkin this year. I do have a volunteer zucchini inside that pumpkin patch, and I don't really want any hybridization going on. I do have plenty of seed, but we can absolutely roast these pumpkin seeds. You can really roast any kind of squash seeds. Some are better than others as far as how good they are on the table. Some squash seeds just are really hard. You like break a tooth trying to eat them, but these, you know, they're like jack-o'-lantern pumpkin seeds, so they should be nice and crispy. And I find that it's easiest to get pumpkin seeds off of the pulp if I run them under some water. And so that's all I'm doing, is just running some water along the pulp and pinching out the seeds and setting those aside. You want this? Nefarious, you're missing out, man. My friend Megan was here the other day dropping off some yogurt so I could freeze dry it, but I wanted to let you guys know that the pumpkin last night for dinner was so, so good. I saw a recipe online where you could roast pumpkin and then shred on some cheese. So I put on our Colby cheese that we made from our goat's milk, and I sprinkled it with a little bit of summer savory, and it was incredible. The combination of sweet and savory with the cheese and the pumpkin was so good, and I'm really excited to be putting some pumpkin away. Now, I did pack up the pumpkin this morning. It was actually pretty late when we got to have our meal last night, so I left the pumpkin in the oven, and then I scooped it out of the skins and actually just put it in a bowl temporarily until I can deal with it. Today is not that day. Probably tomorrow we'll actually package it up for the freezer, but I need to get Megan's yogurt out of the freeze dryer. This looks exactly like freeze-dried milk when I've made that in the past, except for I know it's yogurt. I watched her load the trays up. She made this yogurt out of her own goat's milk. She keeps Nubians, mini Nubians, and Nigerians. One of the awesome things about freeze-drying things and rehydrating them, things like this, is you can actually tailor your concentration to your liking. So let's say she wanted a thicker yogurt when it came to rehydrating this, she could just add less water and get a thicker yogurt that way. That was essentially like a concentrate of the previous yogurt. I've seen people too put yogurt inside like a Ziploc bag and cut the tip out of the bag, kind of like to make a piping bag. And then they'll pipe out little tiny dots of yogurt onto the freeze dryer tray to make like those baby yogurt drops that you could buy at the store. I haven't done that yet. I have freeze dried kefir in the past, and kefir is like a drinkable yogurt. And that turned out just as well as this did. Now, storing these inside a Mylar bag, I like to use oxygen absorbers. When I'm storing for short term in like a jar or something, I will use a desiccant pack in order to keep moisture out. But the oxygen absorber is really good for long-term storage. And so when I use Mylar, I like to go all the way and use what they suggest. Now, this is my heat sealer. It came with my freeze dryer, and that is what's gonna seal these bags, which also came with my freeze dryer. I like to double seal just to be sure. There we go. And this is all the liquid that came out, all the ice on the inside there. Isn't that awesome? Is the 22nd. So I actually didn't film anything for yesterday, but it doesn't mean I didn't do anything. So I picked our first harvest of chicken and dumplings cow peas during the garden tour that I filmed yesterday. And that evening, yesterday evening, my husband and I sat down together and watched the goats graze and shelled peas. It's easily my favorite summertime activity, my favorite farm activity of all time. So relaxing, so enjoyable. But we put all the peas that we got in this tray here to dry out. Some of the peas that we picked were already dry and crispy, but a lot of them, the peas still had a lot of moisture in them. I think you may be able to tell the difference in size. Now, some of the ones that were quite juicy yesterday are looking a lot less so today, but they'll all be probably about this size when they're done. And I've just been letting these air dry. So I've talked about before how we're in the middle of fly season and usually I won't leave anything open for the flies to land on. For some reason, they never mess with my black-eyed peas or these chicken and dumplings cow peas. I don't know what it is. So what I've done is just put them in this tray and they're actually sitting in my shed. But a couple times a day, I'll go through here and just kind of stir things around, trying to give these guys maximum airflow and let all the different peas have an equal amount of air exposure. And it usually takes about, let's say 2 to 5 days, depending on how many peas are in the tray and how well our dehumidifier is doing in the shed. And then we'll be able to pack these up. But these guys are not quite ready. So this here is the extra pumpkin that I put in the fridge that was roasted a couple of days ago. There's actually a lot of it and it's amazing. I want to pack this up for the freezer. We really enjoyed having this savory with cheese, but we could also sweeten it and use it to make pumpkin pie. So I'm going to be putting it away unsalted, unflavored. I don't want to add anything like sugar or anything to it. I want to keep all my options open. I also saved the seeds from the pumpkin and we are going to roast these. It would be a shame to waste them. So I have this little tray down here and I'm just going to be placing these on. I have this bacon fat that we jarred up. I think it was last week. We've gone through half of it already and I'm just going to add this couple teaspoons to the top of the seeds here. And this is all I'm going to do to flavor it. I'm going to take my hand, make sure all the seeds are coated in that bacon fat. If you didn't have the bacon fat, just some kind of oil to coat them with so that they get nice and toasty, and you can salt them if needed. I'm not going to do that because the bacon fat already has quite a lot of salt in it. I've heard of people adding things like ranch dressing and stuff, like powdered ranch dressing. Really, the world's your oyster with these. I've got my oven preheating to 400 and I'm just gonna throw these in. It usually takes about 15 minutes to roast. Okay, so I'm gonna be putting this pumpkin in a couple different types of containers for the freezer. I have these 16-ounce or 1-pound containers that I used to put my butter and chev in, but I figured out that I liked the smaller size better for both of those things. So I have those and I have this extra takeout container. I think this is probably a quart size. It's a good idea to keep in mind kind of your end goal with stuff like this. So if I had a recipe that I really liked for making like a pumpkin bread or pumpkin cookies, I would look at the recipe. And let's say that recipe calls for 1 cup of pumpkin, but I like to double the recipe. It's probably smart for me to put away 2 cup portions of pumpkin. So just a little tip. I like freezing in these canisters as opposed to something like a Ziploc bag. I have Ziploc bags and I'll probably have to use them for some of this, but the Ziploc bags are a lot less reusable than something like this. I have seen people wash and reuse Ziploc bags, but for some reason, I don't know if I'm just rough with them in the freezer or whatever, mine always get holes or rips and I can never get them to last. So I like using these.
all of these that are right here, I have used at least once before and just hand washed it. So when you have cold contents inside, like a room temperature vessel like this, you do get some condensation that starts to bead up on the outside. And it makes labeling a little bit difficult. Even if you have tape or whatever, that doesn't really stick very well. But I think I'll know what this is just based on the color of the contents. So I'm just gonna throw it in the freezer. Came inside, smelled something lovely. So I'm just gonna give our pumpkin seeds a quick little stir. This is actually the harvest basket from the garden tour that I filmed yesterday. And I've got some squash. We have some eggplant that is getting a little bit wilty. I probably shouldn't have left it out, but we can cook that really soon. But what I'm really after right now are these tomatoes. I will eventually get to making the ketchup using the Mrs. Wages packs. I just don't know when I'm gonna have the time or energy. And the great thing about tomatoes, and a lot of people do this, is that you can absolutely freeze them for later. Many people won't even preserve their tomatoes during the height of the growing season because tomatoes freeze and process so well after they're frozen. So we're gonna do that again, core and score some tomatoes and get to them when we can. Gorgeous and meaty these pink ox hearts are. Can you guys believe that I did it again? I burned another thing. That is so funny. But you know, like when you're showing daily life, like goodness, for an entire month, daily vlogging for food preservation, guarantee that more than one thing is gonna go wrong, right? Like it's just part of it. So I know that every family has that one person that actually kind of enjoys that like char flavor. And so in our family, that's my husband, and I bet you he's gonna eat these. It's not too horrible, right? Like they're not all black. I like it.
Nefarious, you don't want this. You don't. Hey girls, I messed up. Can you turn those into eggs? You eat anything, don't you, Feral? My goodness. There's almost nothing that a flock of chickens can't make right.
Hello and welcome back to my kitchen. It is the 23rd. So last week we put in some brisket in a bin like this to make our own corned beef, and I believe it is ready. So tomorrow we have some friends coming over to help me disease test our goats, and I would like to put some of this corned beef in the crock pot tomorrow. But this is a really big brisket and we're not going to be eating the whole thing, so I think probably half of it I can stick in the freezer. So we're not going to get to taste test this today, me physically today, but tomorrow we will taste test it, and I will include that in this video. But this is what we've got. So the recipe that I used to make this corned beef doesn't have curing salt in it. That type of curing salt is what makes corned beef retain that really nice pinky color, and we don't get that when we don't use the curing salt. Oh, here we go, that's the inside. It actually kind of reminds me of a slab of bacon as it is right now, and as you can tell, the redness of the meat has remained. We just didn't get that pink throughout because we didn't use the curing salt, but this should be really good. So if you are going to be processing your own meat animals at all, really no matter what they are, they don't have to be big like cows or goats or deer in order for these 2 gallon Ziploc bags to be really useful. Some animals like turkeys have some really long bones on them, and the 1 gallon bags don't work as well for a lot of different things. So I've really been enjoying these 2 gallon freezer bags. I'm gonna stick one of these in each. Now some of you might wonder if this brine can be reused. Now this is my first time doing anything like this, so I can't really say from experience with this specifically, but when I've tried to reuse like a marinade for jerky or things like that, I find that the salt content that was in the original marinade does really soak into the meat itself. And in order for brines and things to be safe, the salinity has to be a certain level. So it's definitely something that I would remake instead of reuse. With things like pickle brine, that's a little bit different because what makes that safe is the vinegar itself. You can notice a difference in the salt content, like if you reuse pickle juice to make pickled eggs and stuff like that. But even if it's a little bit less salty, the vinegar keeps that safe. When I do reuse pickle brine to make refrigerator pickled eggs, I only reuse the brine one time. Do what I can to squeeze as much of the air out of this as possible. If I was going to be planning to store this in the deep freeze for a longer length of time, let's say I wanted it to keep until St. Patrick's Day next year, I'd probably wrap this in some butcher paper or double bag it just to keep freezer burn at bay. You can vacuum seal meats. My vacuum sealer broke a couple of videos ago. This one seems a little bit weightier, so I think this is the one that we'll keep out to cook tomorrow, and then this one is going in the freezer. There we go. I did decide to wrap it up. Now I am multitasking today, which can be a little bit dangerous. I have some peppers in the oven roasting, and I'm trying to pay close attention to them because my last time I tried to roast peppers was a decent fail. I do have the oven a little bit cooler than I had the last time I tried to roast peppers. And then this time, while I'm roasting them whole instead of cutting them. I'm trying to avoid getting like a crispy, dry pepper like I got last time. So far, so good. I actually just remembered about the sauerkraut that I set up about a month ago, probably. It's been sitting in my bedroom. Ooh, it smells good. Now this cabbage is not cabbage we grew. It's cabbage that I bought from one of our local Amish farm stands. I've got a picky eater in my household, and for some reason she loves sauerkraut. You'd think that wouldn't be a picky eater thing, but it is. And so I've made some for her and I want to taste it. I did notice that my brine level is a little bit low, so I've got some whey here that I'm just gonna top it off with and then stick this in the fridge because it is exactly to our liking. I have a lot of seeds started for the fall and winter. It's quite a few cabbages and I really hope they do well because making sauerkraut out of homegrown cabbage, especially like the red varieties, it's so fun and so good. Alright, that looks a lot better. Yeah, this... we're gonna have success this week, you guys. What I have here is a mix of Cornrow del Toro peppers, Marconi peppers. I also have some pimento peppers here. Just put them all in. So in order to get the skins to slip off nicely, they need to steam a little bit. A lot of people suggest covering with plastic wrap, but I don't have any. So we're just gonna use what I've got. And I have been told that it's best to skin them when they're warm. So I'm just gonna let these steam for 5-10 minutes and then we'll try to get the skins off. We did it. This is exactly what I hoped for out of our red pepper harvest this year. And you guys helped me with it. My first attempt at roasted red peppers was a complete fail. And instead of getting condescending comments like, oh, she doesn't know what she's talking about, look at her. You guys came into the comments and offered some very helpful, very useful advice that helped me learn. And then this video in turn will help more people learn, and that's what I love about this community. I could use this for dinner this week, just like this. I wouldn't necessarily have to preserve it. We could freeze these for later. I've seen people freeze dry them. One thing that I've seen to help
increase the life of the peppers in the refrigerator is that some people will store them in olive oil. And so I think I'd like to do that. There is kind of a decent amount of juice in with these peppers right now, just from the peppers. It's a very like concentrated sugary type juice. It's good, I tasted it. So that is in here, and I am just going to kind of debubble around the peppers and try to settle in this olive oil and all the nooks and crannies to help preserve them in the refrigerator. And of course, this olive oil is also going to add good healthy fats as well as great flavor and like hydration for the peppers. They did come out really juicy straight from the oven though. I think we got them in good timing this time. Top this off with olive oil. And then this is refrigerator bound. We can probably keep this in the fridge for a good few months until we're ready to use them. We have given the dinner table to the children, so I'm sitting down here. But this is the corned beef that we made ourselves. And I'm actually really pleasantly surprised, without using curing salts, how much of like the pinky color of the meat was retained, and it's delicious. You like it? You'll?
Oh, yes.
Serve it up with our sauerkraut. Both things are technically fermented. Isn't that funny? Did you try it? Is that yummy?
He won't even touch
it. He likes his pretzel.
He likes pretzels though. The pretzel's good?
Very good.
You like it?
I am a fan. It's not like the corned beef you'd get out of the grocery store in like the lunch meat aisle.
How is it different?
The taste, the texture, the everything. It's all just amazing. No, I'm a huge fan. Well done.
Thanks. You've got a full mouth. What do you think?
What he said.
This freezer, it really needs a good de-icing. And it has tomatoes in it from 2022. That probably should be dealt with. Cilantro, really? Bell peppers from 2021. Oh my goodness. So at the moment, what I'm doing with these old nightshades that I dug out of this deep freeze is just letting everything thaw out. It is going to be the next food preservation video, so next Monday, where you see how I dealt with these. This week is done though, so I'm gonna end this here. I'll see you guys again soon.